All right. Hello, everybody. Yay. All right. Welcome to the Drupal NYC meetup here at 30 Rock, the August edition. We were talking about it earlier, and I think that our year anniversary of being in this space is coming up next meetup. So that's pretty cool. We haven't had a space for a year consistently in a long time. So welcome. My name is Alex Ross. I work here at NBC. We are a big company. We do a lot of Drupal things with a lot of Drupal people. And we've been really involved with this group for a while, so we're excited to kind of work with you guys every month. All right, let's get started. Before the housekeeping things, I like to have an interesting piece of trivia or something, and I found one out from our NBC pages who helped escort you up to this room. Jimmy Fallon of The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon, his original major in college was computer science until he switched to communications and then dropped out of school and now makes more money than all of us combined. Okay. Housekeeping. Restrooms. There is a women's restroom down stage left hallway all the way down on your right. There is a men's restroom down the stage right hallway all the way down on your left. There are also some gender neutral restrooms on the stage right hallway all the way down on your right. So please make use of those if you need to. Please mute your devices. If they beep or jingle or anything like that, please make sure they're on mute. We are recording this, which we'll talk about in a second. And the beeping and jingling, you know, messes with the recordings a little bit and bothers other people and all that good stuff. So please go on mute or vibrate or whatever that is. Throughout the evening, if you are going to be asking questions, please try and use the mic. Ho Ling is over there holding her mic up. Hi, Ho Ling. Yay! And I think we'll have Tony as well. Hi, Tony. Woo! They'll be running around with mics, so try and grab a mic if you ask a question for the purposes of the recording so we can have the question recorded with the answer. If you're presenting and someone asks a question without using the mic, try and repeat it, and we'll be good. All right, so that's our housekeeping. Agenda, the first thing, it's always weird that we keep that on the agenda, and we do this every month, and every month I get flustered by that first thing being at 6 o'clock. Doors open, socializing and pizza, sponsored by NBC. We've already done that, right? Everybody had some good pizza. 6:30 is this right now, some announcements. We'll do some quick introductions, and then we have three great talks scheduled for today. Two of them are on the PowerGraphs module, but kind of in different aspects of and different ways of using it. And the third one is Richard's, and I already forgot what he's talking about. But we're gonna bring up a slide. Richard's going to tell us all about something really, really amazing. After that, we'll the 2 minutes of talking, and Fastly, thanks to our friends at Fastly, is sponsoring, as usual, our after-party gathering, some drinks down at Bill's Bar, which is right downstairs in this building. The entrance is on 51st Street, and I always get it wrong. We're usually in the top bar, but maybe we're at the bottom bar. But if you go to one bar in Bill's Bar and you don't see anybody who you see right now, go to the other bar in Bill's Bar, and you will find the people. That's the agenda. A couple other things. Oh, here we go. Here are our talks, right? So I haven't seen him yet, but if Artem gets here in time, he will be giving his talk on building landing pages in D8 with Paragraphs module. Super interesting stuff. And then Richard's going to be talking about content audits. He's going to tell us how to make content audits great again. And then finally, we're going to have a case study from two folks on Paragraphs with a headless architecture, hybrid headless architecture. So that's, you can see how they're pretty different Paragraphs topics here, but some interesting stuff. And that's going to be Pete and Will. So we'll get to those in just a couple minutes. In addition, I generally do kind of a newbie boff thing out in the hallway over there. I'll wave and let everybody know when I go out there. It's more of like an ask me anything kind of scenario. If you have, hey, what's the best module to use for X? Or I've been battling this one problem on my site for 6 months. Can you please just help me take a look at it? I'm happy to do that. So I'll be out there at some point during the evening. Tonight's organizers. So all the organizers, wave your hands, right? All right. I like to have everybody wave their hands so that you know who the organizers are. If you have questions or suggestions or feedback or, you know, things that you'd like to see at these events, those are the organizers. Definitely, like, pull one of them aside and give them the feedback. And we definitely take that feedback to heart. So please, you know, give us that. We want to make this as enjoyable a meetup as we can every single month. The venue, the food, and the drinks are all sponsored by NBCU Technology. So we thank our friends at NBCU Technology. Yay! A couple of our friends from NBC are out there right now. As I said before, we're hiring. Those are the people to go talk to because we're hiring. And you can go say hello to them and say thanks for the pizza. They also have some swag out there. I saw some really nifty nail files, but I think there's some other stuff too. And then, as I mentioned before, Fastly, yay, is sponsoring our drinks downstairs afterwards. So we're always grateful to our friends at Fastly. Thank you for that. Photos. We encourage everybody to take photos during these meetups. Post them online at the various places where you post photos with hashtags. The official hashtag is DrupalNYC, but we really encourage it because it makes people jealous that they forgot to come or they couldn't make it or whatnot, and it encourages people to come the very next time when they see all the fun and exciting things going on here. So please do take pictures and upload them wherever you upload them. Meetup.com/DrupalNYC is kind of our official meetup page, but also the Twitters and the Instagrams and the other things too. Upcoming events. Okay, so coming in just a couple weeks is Midwest Drupal Summit. I believe that one's the one in Chicago. It's in Ann Arbor. Ooh, Ann Arbor, Michigan. Very nice. All right. So that's coming up August 19th to 21st. There is a Drupal NYC Play Day. We do this once a month. This month it is Saturday, August 20th, and it's in the Phase 2, it's the Phase 2 offices. Phase 2 offices, so that's fantastic. Thank you to Phase 2. But yeah, that's a great place to come and like actually sit down with your computer, start writing some code, have somebody else who's writing code to help each other out. You're kind of, you know, getting good at this, but not really great. You know, ask someone who's an expert and they'll help you with your problem, or, you know, find someone who's a beginner and see if you can help them with their problem. It's our super secret plan to kind of help move people up on the Drupal ladder in terms of their skill and their competencies and enjoyment and other such fun things. Okay, Drupal Camp Connecticut coming up real soon, Saturday, August 20th, same day. So you can go in the morning to Drupal Play Day, hop on the train and go to Drupal Camp Connecticut for the afternoon. Perfect. I don't know which city in Connecticut it's in, but New Haven. All right, so at the end of the line, right? Just get on the Metro North. We're good. That's Saturday, August 20th. Then we have Drupal NYC Happy Hour. We do this. This meeting that we're in right now is the first Wednesday of every month. The Happy Hour is typically the last Wednesday of every month. So this month, that is August 31st. It's usually at House of Brews, but I feel like lately we've been looking for a different venue, especially during the summer, because it's like nice out and something where the outdoor something. But if you go to meetup.com/DrupalNYC, you can get all the details about that. And just, you know, it's just good people who have similar interests and go there and talk about the Olympics or whatever. It doesn't have to be Drupal talk, but there's some great people that go and show up all the time. Finally, DrupalCon is coming up in Europe. This year it's in Dublin. DrupalCon Dublin, September 26th through 30th. It is just recently, the speakers have all been announced and all the sessions that are going to be there. So take a look, and if you can get a last minute deal, I hear after Brexit it's like super cheap to fly to Ireland and the UK, so maybe. So DrupalCon Dublin. If you've never been to a DrupalCon, they're really, really amazing events. It's the European one's usually 2,000 to 3,000 people who are all, you know, hardcore Drupalin that whole week, hardcore partying that whole week. You know, whatever the mix is that you particularly enjoy, you can kind of make for yourself. And it's a good time, and there's a lot of good conversations that go on about the future of the project, a lot of good conversations going on about kind of where the project is right now. So I highly encourage people to go to a DrupalCon if you can. Next year, the DrupalCon North America is in Baltimore. That's in like next, I guess, May or so-ish. So it should be really easy for all us to go and like rent one Acela train together and just like charter a train down there. It'll be great. Okay, we'll see what we can do about that. All right, the Drupal Association. Join the Drupal Association. We highly encourage everybody to do this. The Drupal Association is very, very helpful both to the Drupal community as a whole. They help support Drupal.org. They help to sponsor certain events. Well, they help to organize certain events and do a lot of like the legal and insurance kind of boring stuff that nobody wants to have to do for all these hundreds of Drupal events that go on. They help with all that stuff. And they provide grants and all sorts of good stuff. So I highly encourage everybody to join the Drupal Association. Okay. Association.drupal.org/membership. You can join for, I think it's any amount at this point, but like $20 or $30 and you're a member. And that's exactly right. There's for your company, you can do an organization-wide membership. Highly, highly, highly encourage helping out the Drupal community in that way. Okay. Interested in speaking, all right? So we always have really great speakers, and we're always looking for really great speakers, and we're always looking for really great topics about our, you know, topics about which our speakers should speak. So generally at these meetups, we have two types of talks, and I just realized that Ben is here, so he's going to tell us all about those types of talks and how to get involved in speaking.
Thanks, Alex. Hi, everybody. So yeah, we usually do two different types of talks, lightning talks, 10 to 15 minutes, followed by a main talk. So that's what we have tonight. We have two lightning talks and a main talk. That format's flexible. Basically, who here, this is their first time at our meetup here? Put your hand up. Awesome. Keep your hand up if you're excited about something that you're working on related to Drupal.
Wow.
Okay, some hands went down. but most people stay up. So I'd love to talk with you about what you're working on and what you're excited about, and maybe you'd like to tell people about what you're working on. So come find me afterward or contact me, my email. Just tell me about what you're doing with Drupal. Maybe you could share to other people so they can learn from you, and maybe, you know, hopefully you learned something from tonight as well. So yeah, two lightning talks, and then we'll have a main talk. You could talk for 10 or 15 minutes. You could talk for 35 minutes if you want, or longer. We're pretty flexible. We just want to share Drupal to more people and hear about some exciting stuff that you're all working on. So thanks.
Yeah. And one more little plug there. It doesn't always have to be like a polished talk, right? There have definitely been times where people have got up here and said, hey, I solved this problem yesterday. Here are the four lines of code I figured out that took me 8 hours. Let me share this with you and explain why it happened. 4-minute lightning talk, and it was super useful for all the people that were there, right? So it can be something as kind of contained and simple as that, all the way up through, you know, one of our talks today will probably be kind of a more, you know, broad topic, you know, 30, 35-minute talk, where they're really going to go over in depth a whole lot of concepts, right? Yeah, I hope. He's sitting there going, no, but it'll be awesome. Okay. What do we got? Who works for a company who is hiring? Raise your hands. Ooh, everyone's hiring. Okay, so real quick, we're just going to keep your hands up. No one told you to put your hands down. We're just going to go around. And what's your company and what position are you hiring for?
Hi, the name of my company is DNA Info, and we're looking for a UX UI designer.
Okay, well, DNA? DNA Info. Got it. Who else? Hands up. You had your hand up.
Sure. Hi, my company is Eventide, and we're looking for someone to help us, I mean, a Drupal developer who's also going to help us with UX.
Okay. Drupal developer with UX?
Blue Cadet, and we're based in Philadelphia. We're looking for Drupal developers. So,
the UN, we're looking in particular for business associates that have to do the forms for our websites desperately, but also Drupal developers.
Okay. The UN, I've heard of them. Anyone else? No? But all right. But give it up for the UN every year lately. They've been helping us with a nice camp. Yeah. We just had an awesome nice camp. Part of Open Camps, right? All the different open source projects around New York got together, made a big giant conference. The UN was our venue. It's a really, really great venue for a conference. So thank you to the UN. Where's the button? Okay, who is looking to be hired? All right, everyone looking to be hired. Wow. Look around. Yeah. Okay, you all saw who was raising their hands. Okay, all right, we're good. Make sure that you tell the people, right? Go find them. Okay, we're good. Introductions. We used to do big, long, ridiculous introductions. It would take like 30 minutes, and it would take half the meetup, and it was terrible. So we decided that was not a good idea based on the feedback we got from all of you. See, we definitely listened to feedback. So instead, we do like to still have kind of a moment of introduction. So everyone take 5 minutes, turn to somebody who is near you, say hello, who you are, what you do, where you work, what's interesting in Drupal, in the Drupal world, whatever it is, and we will be back in 5 minutes. So introduce yourself to someone you don't know. And go. We'll switch it over in a second.
Okay.
But plug yourself in and make sure you're good. And freeze. That works with my 3-year-old, but only sometimes. All right, so we're going to keep going. Everybody who's in the middle of a conversation should remember who they were in the middle of the conversation with, so when you go downstairs later for drinks at Bill's Bar, you'll know exactly who to continue your conversation with. All right, we're going to move on to our first topic, our first talk for the day. This talk is called Building Landing Pages on Drupal 8 with, oh, I took my sheet away.
With
the paragraphs module, but I usually have a note about who you are.
Oh.
But you're going to introduce yourself,
yes,
because I forgot the sheet and I put it over there.
No worries.
But yeah, we're going to talk about easily building landing pages with paragraphs module, and we're going to get a demo from Artem, mm-hmm. and you're going to introduce yourself.
Yes.
Artem, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi, guys.
Woo!
Hi, guys. My name is Artem. I'm a technical project manager in Tribeca Digital. It's a local agency here in New York, and recently we had a number of projects where we were building. Oh, let me share my screen. Where we were building really simple one-pager sites. We had a number of them, and because they were so simple, we decided to go with Drupal 8 and give it a try. And at the same time, because those are one-scroll sites. Typically for Drupal 7, we used panels and panelizer for that, but in this case, we decided to try something else. Just one second. We looked at paragraph module and tried it, and we got great results. And I wanted to share with you how it works. So this is the site, one of the examples. It's a promotional site for upcoming movie called Friday's Child. And as you can see, it consists of sections. We have a slider section, a big quote here, then some description of the movie, followed by cast and crew, gallery, another text block, and then contact us. So let me show you how we can build this type of site using paragraph in Drupal 8. And I think Drupal 7 will work the same way, but I haven't tried paragraphs in Drupal 7. For some reason, I thought that it's not stable or reliable. I don't know why I had this thing, and we were using panels and panelizer, but in Drupal 8, everything is new. So you kind of have this idea that nothing is stable for now, but it is. And we tried paragraphs, it worked well. So I will build a few blocks from this site, and this simple description block, cast and crew, and partnership block. So I will start with cast and crew. It's I have a new Drupal 8 install with some modules, paragraph module and a few other modules installed, but other than that, it's vanilla Drupal almost. So we'll start with creating content types, and the first content type I will create is a person content type for cast and crew section. This will be name, we don't need preview, published. Now if we look at this block, so we have people here and I would say they have three fields. One is the name of the person, role in the movie, and their profile picture. So let me quickly add those fields. We don't need a body for the field. We already have a name, which is the title of the node, and I will add and we'll call it profile picture. We'll use all the default settings. So you have a profile picture. And let's add another field for role in Zamuda. So it's a simple text field. Now, when we have these fields defined, let's also configure display for them. We don't need labels, so they will be hidden. And we don't need links here. Let's quickly go and create a few pieces of content for people. So we have Ty Sheridan. I will add him first. And his role is Richie. And then let's add another person. And she plays John. Now that we have this content type and some content, let's go and create a paragraph that we will be using to manage this content on the landing page. I go to paragraph types and create the first paragraph for this section. The first paragraph will be cast and crew. Yeah, adding this paragraph, and then we need to add some fields. We'll be using entity reference to reference this content with this content type. The first step, actually, I will do a step back. Each section of the site has a title: synopsis, cast and crew, gallery, partnership. So the first things we will do, we'll add a field for a section title. Which is just a plain, simple field. And then we'll add entity reference to the contact. That would be cast. On our mockup, we have four people here, so we'll change this to four elements. No default values. Sorry. Oh, right, sorry, I didn't see it. Thank you. So now we have one paragraph. Let's quickly add another. And the second paragraph will be text section. We'll use this paragraph for sections like this synopsis and this partnership. So this will be a quick one. Text section. And this for this paragraph type, we'll add an existing field of section title. Because we already have that, we will just reuse it. And then another field will be section body. So So now that we have paragraph type, let's create a new content type called landing pages. The landing page, that would be a base for our pages, and we'll associate paragraphs with landing page so that we can create the sections dynamically. So add content type, it will be landing page. As a title, we'll have page title, no preview. Landing page will have only one field. It will be a paragraph field. So we don't need body here. We will have unlimited number of paragraphs, and then we define what paragraphs we want to use. We'll use cast and crew and text section. Now that we have everything set up, let's create the first landing page. And our landing page will be a home page. So that's the page title. And then we can add as many paragraphs as we want, or sections. And this will be the first one, synopsis. I will first create it just as a title without anything else, and I will expand that later. Then the second one will be cast and crew. So we have cast, where we can select tie, Sheridan, and him again. The benefit of this solution is that we can drag and drop this around, because it's often a requirement from the client to be able to rearrange content on the homepage, and also we can drag and drop sections around and change their order. And let's add another text section. This will be, it will be a partnership. And we'll save this page. So this is default output. I don't have a theme, obviously, but it's easy to configure that using display mode and then theme it so that it looks better. You will notice that partnership layout is different from synopsis, yet I use the same paragraph for that. One of the alternatives is that we can build a paragraph in such a way that each element on this block is a separate field. So that will be image one, text two, image two. But this way, it's not very flexible. And if client decides to add more paragraphs or get rid of this image, we will need to change the structure and theming. Instead, I found that using WYSIWYG templates, it's a much better solution for that. And with Drupal 8, it's really easy to extend WYSIWYG configuration. So with a simple module, just 1 second. So with a simple custom module, just 1 second, sorry. You can build your own templates for WYSIWYG, and then that would allow editors to select a template from the WYSIWYG, and it already will be pre-formatted. We can have two columns, we can have image with a site, text, so it's really easy to add that, and then in the admin interface, if I go back to edit mode, so for synopsis section, we have these templates defined here, so we can have, for example, this, and for partnership, we can use another template. For example, that. And then we'll save it. And it creates this HTML, so you don't need to manually put HTML. the template is already here. You just need to replace image with the image that you want or just put the content that you want. So this is a very quick demo, what you can do with Paragraph module and how you can structure. The rest of the sections is very similar to what we've done. So gallery, it's just an entity reference to media item entity. And then contact us, it's another text section with another template that you can build easily. And same for the slider, it's another entity reference section for media items. So that's all. Any questions?
Can you scroll down slightly? Right there. So the formatting of these images and the titles, this is automated by what you just did. Is it intentional to have these be misaligned or unintentional, or is that just how it ends up?
This is design treatment, so that's how the designer came up with this layout.
Okay.
This is one of the questions we had for the designer, what the logic was. We haven't clarified it yet. I mean, it's easy to do with CSS, just hard code. It's not a very good solution probably, but you can find ways how to work around this.
Hi. One of the challenges we've had, you know, if you're doing this a while, you end up running into the same sites over, you know, through iterations over the years, of having HTML be in the sort of WYSIWYG. Mm-hmm. Have you found any solutions to that, or are you just kind of deal with it as you go when the the designs change and you want to, you know, change those layouts and things like that?
Right. So design changes all the time, and it's always a challenge, and you always have to go back and recreate. We found it's easier to have like WYSIWYG body, one field for the section, especially when the layout is this simple. It's much easier to change the template here in the code than to create another fields, like some fields will be removed, some will be added. And in addition to that, each field is another table. So it's a performance implications rather than have one field. So. Yeah, we just started with this approach, with paragraphs and HTML templates. So far it worked well, but we'll see how it goes.
If you change the template, it doesn't automatically
change. No, you will need to go and recreate the content. Usually when the layout changes, the content will also change, so you will have to change it anyway.
Hi. Do you have the template module? Is it something public? I didn't really listen.
So for the template, this is actually CK Editor plugins. I just add them via custom Drupal plugin, include them to CK Editor. Let me quickly show you. It's hard to see. Quickly switch to some two different mode. Sorry. Okay, now I will see the same as you. So basically, this is a Drupal 8 plugin that allows you to extend CK Editor. And you can put your own JavaScript plugins here. And they will be added to CK Editor configuration. This is like a plugin from CK Editor repository. I just connected it to Drupal, and you can use it with CK Editor. I did it a while ago. I don't remember the details, but I followed the instructions. It's pretty easy. There are like no complexity to that.
Yes.
Thank you.
very much. Thank you. All right. Where's Richard? There he is, coming on down. He's been talking about audits and making them awesome again. Richard, where are you working at?
Stony Brook University.
Stony Brook University out on Long Island. Right there where they found DNA for the first time. Right next door, yeah.
I don't even know that.
Yeah, that's where DNA was discovered. Watson and Crick, right? That's right at Stony Brook. Ooh, uh-oh.
I didn't make that claim.
Cold Spring Harbor. Thwarted again. All right, so I tried something and it just failed completely. Richard, take it away.
Okay. I'm really happy you guys all had a laugh at that because there's going to be a lot more of this stuff coming, and I felt I knew the audience well enough to have this fly. All right, so has anyone here ever performed a content audit on their sites? Was it the most fun you've ever had or what? Okay, so this talk stemmed. Ben and I had a conversation last meetup, and I've been going through a content audit on our site. I run a couple websites for Stony Brook University. Specifically, IT department kind of has a large website that we're in charge of. And we migrated to Drupal about 5 years ago, and we haven't really done a strong evaluation of our content since then. Sites kind of grow, designs change, goals shift over time. And so I think it's kind of important that you perform these content audits. And it's something that we want to do every year. But the drudgery and the pain and the size, it is a little bit intimidating. The tools that are out there don't necessarily always make it easier, right? So we're going to talk about some of the approaches that we've taken, some research I've done, try to take some of the pain out of this. My name's Rich. I work at Stony Brook University. The slides, there's some URLs and stuff, so if you want to grab the deck, it's at that address. So I think first, we should define some terms. Content inventories are basically where you go and define kind of the actual content you have on your site. It's a listing of what you already have, and then the audit side of things is kind of evaluating how good it is, right? There are a lot of tools out there that kind of help with the inventory side of things as far as telling you what you got, but the audit side of things is kind of more, your own opinion, right? It's much more subjective, qualitative. So typically, in an inventory, what you're looking for is things like the actual URLs, so every URL, hopefully, in your site. Maybe the page titles, if there's any metadata. You can tie in your analytics, so is this page just getting a ton of views, right? Is this page not getting the types of traffic you would expect? Maybe if you're doing social metrics, you want to know how many shares a news article is getting, are you hitting your goals on that kind of content? One thing that's kind of coming into play on our side now is the weight of the pages, right? We focused, we're actually a big paragraph shop now as well, but we've brought in a lot of rich imagery, a lot more content, and so the pages themselves are getting heavier with this kind of long scroll content, and so that's something we want to kind of keep track of. As well as you can even dive a little bit deeper into the content itself, right? So what do your H1 tags look like across your whole site, right? So you're talking about search engine optimization and how findable your content actually is. There's some things on the inventory side of things, on the inventory side, that you can kind of pull out as well automatically. Things like is this content fresh? How old is it? When's the last time someone touched it or edited it? Who's the owner, right? Who do I track down or beat up when they're not using the right kind of semantic HTML or design patterns, that kind of stuff? As well as, just the content type itself, right? Is this a news article? Is this a service page? Is this a KB article? That kind of stuff. And as well as just the links on the page, resources, files, videos, just kind of get a feel of what's actually on the page. When you talk about an audit, you're typically looking more at, against the quality side of things. So when you talk about content quality, is it fresh? Is it accurate? Is it actually telling the truth, right? A lot of our stuff on our site are KB articles where we're explaining how to use a service in a particular way. Those things kind of get stale and outdated, and so we want to make sure the information is accurate for our students and our customers, or faculty and staff. again, our design on the page is now very paragraph-based, and we're giving up more freedom to our editors. With that freedom comes really interesting design choices. So sometimes you want to evaluate those choices and make sure that they're staying kind of in brand or on focus with what you're expecting. And then there's structural issues, right? Like, is this page accessible? Where does it sit in the navigation? Are people able to find it? Does it come up really good in search? Is your meta tags and your keywords useful or actually good? And then also, at the same time, you want to kind of gauge, like, is this page important, right? So you can track your thoughts, again, on the page with the actual kind of metrics you're getting from your inventory and say, like, you know, we really expected this page to get a lot more hits this semester, but it didn't. Like, did we fail at something? Is this really not as important to our users as we thought it would be? That kind of stuff. Is the content speaking to your personas, your audience, effectively, right? Like, are you actually telling the story you want to the right type of person? Or are you kind of hitting a different demographic than you would expect? And then how effective is the content, right? Like, you, again, this can tie back into your analytics. Like, are people coming to the page and bouncing off after 10 seconds or something like that? Or are they really kind of invested in the content? So like I said, like frequency is kind of an issue on our side of things. Like, I think most of us, when we do a content audit, it comes at the beginning of a project, right? You're trying to get a handle of what already exists, right? So like, it's a discovery phase. I'm sure a lot of you work for agencies where you bring in a new client and you don't know anything about kind of the content or what the site actually is, right? So you kind of like use the content audit as a tool to kind of learn more about that area of interest. A lot of times, like a redesign might spark the need for it to do an audit, right? So after you kind of come through the design, like the previous speaker mentioned, like a change of design often necessitates a change in content, right? So you want to make sure that the new design and the content are actually working well together. So you, maybe you'll do the content audit after an implementation like that. And then content owners themselves probably benefit from doing an audit more seasonally, right? There's some content that maybe is important for us at the start of a semester, and then that content might change over time and for the end of the semester. So doing things seasonally or yearly might be a good approach. All right. Came up with this acronym. I think I shoehorned in a reference here. But basically, like, the idea is you go through the process, you're going to do the discovery phase, right? That's the inventory itself. That's where you're kind of gathering the URLs. If you're in Drupal, you can export a list of nodes. There are plenty of tools out there that can give you, kind of like crawl your site and give them to you, give you like a list in a spreadsheet or something like that. Then you're going to actually go through the evaluation and categorization process, right? So, like, is this content good, bad? What do I do with it? Like, what kind of actions do we want to take on this content? And then typically we try to assign the content a priority and, like, an owner. Who's going to actually affect the change, right? We have thousands of nodes. I'm not going to edit every page. That's just impossible. And then the last step is actually fixing the content. All right, so when you talk about the inventory side of things, there's a lot of automated tools, and with those tools come a lot of promises, right? Like, we'll scan your site, and we'll give you, you know, metrics and scores, and we'll tell you how great your content is. Most of the time, that's kind of an empty promise, right? Like, it's not actually going to give you, there's no magic solutions. A lot of times, you have to go through page by page and perform these audits kind of by hand and to really get a good assessment, right? We'll look at some of the tools. You'll see that, like, another problem that kind of comes up a lot is a lot of the tools are either old, they're outdated, specifically like Xenu, their website looks like it was made in 1993. There's not a lot of like activity in this space, especially in the open source side of things, right? Like, a lot of the products that do exist, they're subscription-based, they cost money. Higher ed, we're kind of thrifty, we don't want to spend money often. And like, especially with these services, is an issue of kind of the content ownership, right? Like, where does that data actually live? Is it a database that you control, or is it a database that you're paying someone to kind of maintain for you? And then if it's not data that you actually can query, like, how effective is it, right? Like, can you actually do the things or learn the things that you want out of that data? One tool that we did buy is this thing called Screaming Frog. I think it's done a pretty good job as far as the inventory side of things. It can tell you your page titles, your headings, all that kind of stuff for you. It's a relatively quick tool, you know, gives you broken link reports, all that fun stuff. A tool that I found in the process of doing some of this research is this thing called URL Profile. Has anyone used it before? Okay, good. I'm not the only one then. This seems to kind of be more of that magic sauce where it's like, it integrates with a lot of third-party services, and it can kind of try to give you more of an audit kind of feel rather than inventory kind of feel. You'll see things like readability. It automatically will tie into your Google Analytics. It could tie into PageRank and Majestic, which kind of gives you kind of a score or a rating on your pages, a trustworthiness factor, that kind of stuff. But again, like that tool is kind of like a for-pay service. The other kind of side of things, right, like you do it yourself, right? Who's created a content inventory on a spreadsheet? Yeah, it's a nightmare, right? Like, it's the best we got, but it's also the worst thing ever. So, like, no parallels intended. So a lot of times, like, you have spreadsheets that kind of look like this. And it works well if you have a dozen pages, right? Like, you're doing those kind of short landing page sites that he kind of just described. It's easy to kind of get your head around. I have 5,000 nodes. I'm not making a spreadsheet like this. It's impossible. How would you keep track of it? How would you get anything useful out of it? You'd spend the rest of the year just filling out the spreadsheet. And you see, it kind of just gets bigger, and very quickly you get overwhelmed. You start creating tons of different kind of columns. You're scrolling left and right. Sometimes you'll start color coding things with some cryptic color scheme that only you understand, and then you go out of it for a week, and you come back, and you have no idea, you know, why is this red? I don't know what this means. I found this interesting spreadsheet. I think there's 156 different data points she collects in this checklist. I don't know. There's just a ton of stuff. Just looking at it, I was like, I can't even begin. Like, there's a lot of really good points, I think, in here. Like, I would definitely recommend going through this, but it is just so overwhelming, the detail that she's trying to collect on her sites. Some of this detail is kind of site overview specific, so you're kind of looking at, like, just general site information, and less, like, on page, but she does kind of have some on page things going on here. So there's a useful checklist to kind of, like, things that maybe you want to be checking or that you should know about your site. Really, at the end of the day, is there any hope, right? Do I have to, like, maybe I should just give up, right? Throw in the towel. There are kind of like some, I think, key things you can do to kind of ensure a more successful content audit, right? I think knowing up front what your goals are. So, like, you can't take all 156 of those checkpoints and expect to do a content audit and hit all of those marks, right? But you probably have some idea going into the problem. Or going into the audit, what type of problems you're trying to solve, right? Are you looking for accessibility issues? Are you looking for SEO optimization things you can do across the site? Are you just looking to find some bad content, right? Like, so defining those goals up front and keeping those kind of goals to a manageable, like, state probably makes a lot of sense. And you got to be honest. Like, the quality of the content, like, we're really good at kind of taking a look at content in a negative kind of side of things and, like, writing notes like, whoever wrote this must be an idiot because this is inaccurate, right? Like, but you got to make sure that the feedback you're giving and the type of data you're collecting is actually going to be effective and people are going to respond well to it so you can actually affect the type of change you're trying to make, right? Sometimes it's important to build walls around your content. You don't want to kind of, like, take the whole site, right? Like, if you have 5,000 nodes, like, maybe you don't need to audit all of them, right? You can take some representational content if you know your content well. You can kind of say things like, you know, I'm going to look at some KB articles. I know that these two dozen KB articles are all, our articles are very templated, so I can look at two dozen of them and get a sense of what the rest, right, the other 500 kind of look like. Like if you're looking for a design kind of audits and tweaks, right, if you have very templated content, that's easier to kind of generalize. You can also focus on just a specific content type. And like I said before, like you can focus on the audit as far as like, what are you actually trying to assess in the audit itself? So take pieces of those kind of checklists and kind of like go through it that way. For me, like I love deleting things. I think burning the site down, starting from scratch, sometimes is the way to go. The more you can delete, the more you prune, the easier it is to kind of get through. You want to eliminate the amount of noise you have on your site so that your high quality content, your content that's actually kind of driving value gets better exposure and is more findable. Again, like the Paragraphs module has helped us with that a little bit by kind of eliminating a lot of leaf nodes and consolidating content onto one landing page. That's increased our kind of search engine like findability. It's made our navigation simpler. It's just kind of decreased the number of stuff across the site. And sometimes, you know, like when you're going through the assessment, like you're prioritizing content, you're saying like, you know, I want to change this heading. It's this heading's duplicative, or like it's just not worded right. I want to kind of like have someone fix this, right? Like it's easy to kind of make those notes and then assign that work to someone who maybe has more free time, or like we have a lot of student employees that kind of work for us, so like, we kind of assign some of that easy pickings to them and get that work done faster, so things happen in parallel, right? Like you don't want to waste developer time doing a lot of these kind of simple tasks. You could reassign it to content owners, but you have to be careful too with that. Their priorities might not be the same as yours, right? And they might have been the one who already created the content poorly to begin with, so like there might be some retraining issue you have to kind of worry about there. So like, do we have other options, right? Like, do we have a third party we can choose? Do you guys know who this is? I didn't know who he was until a week ago. So what we did is we kind of created, like, I didn't want to go through it and give a demo because it's kind of boring. But we created a custom tool that we kind of put our kind of categories and heuristics. I don't know if I can zoom in any slides. But these buttons basically, like, they'll pull up a page. So we do this kind of on a multi-window or multi-monitor kind of setup, sometimes in a conference room, where the page will be, like, up on a projector, and I'll be at the control panel here. And we'll have a room, so maybe we'll get the content owners together, and we'll focus on a specific site or section of the site that they're in charge of. And we can kind of just quickly, like, bang through this, right? Is this content good? Yes. Is the content bad? All right, you click this button instead. Should we delete this page? Should we consolidate this page? So you quickly can kind of like rattle through this. It's building a SQL database for you that you then query and actually do useful things against instead of Excel spreadsheets, which is just the magic, I guess. At the same time, like we have prioritization. So like, is this something that like we want to work on right away? We've integrated some of our analytics and some of that stuff coming out of Screaming Frog. So like the page size, the count. So that might help inform our decision on whether or not this is good quality content or poor content. And you basically just click a button and the next page loads. So we can kind of rattle through 50 pages in an hour. Like we try to do a page a minute. Usually you get lost in the woods on something. But it's kind of really sped up the process and it's got us out of like worrying about how the spreadsheet looks and just got us to kind of focus on the reports. Also like we try to, after we get the report out, we might cycle some of that data back into Drupal itself so that you have the categorization, you have the priority, you know that this is good representational content so that in a year from now when you're doing this again, you can kind of quickly, let me see all the sites that we, all the pages that we think are high quality, like high quality pages or high importance pages. You can pull a view really together really quick and you can kind of focus on that right away. Or if you're doing like a big major redesign, you can kind of quickly assess your important pages right away and make sure you didn't break anything. So here's some references. That's my Twitter handle. Any questions? Where is Obama? Didn't make the cut. Awesome, no questions. Favorite. Oh, sorry.
Sorry. So do you take an iterative process here, or do you try to like do these things and then get the product out, or do you try to kind of munch on them week by week?
Yeah, I think iterative is the way we do everything. We're agile. Well, lowercase a and probably not spelled correctly. Mostly, like, we'll try to take a small kind of chunk. Maybe we'll do 50 pages at the beginning of the week. We'll carve them out. I'll assign them to who should be doing the work. Sometimes our team, like I said, we have some students who have some free time over the summer. Like, we'll try to take on and lift some of the heavier repetitive things. But at the end of the day, like, maybe it's a question of just, like, what is the 12-step process to changing your password on campus, right? Like, that's someone that whoever owns that kind of process needs to answer. And again, it's a kind of balancing with them, making sure that they know that this is important to get in, like, up to date and make sure it's correct. So it's kind of like it's a cat and mouse game. But we try not to have too many things kind of out there in the weeds, right? Like, another issue we have is, like, people putting stuff in draft and keeping it in draft forever. And then it's like, is this ready to publish? Who gets to make that call? So we try to, like, always kind of keep a small list and then like every other week kind of go back and forth and re-follow up and make sure that progress is happening. Otherwise, things just kind of get lost.
Can you pop back to the URL with your deck on it?
And there's notes in the slides and stuff. Probably doesn't line up with anything I actually said, but Follow-up
question. Do you use anything like user voice or any sort of, you know, getting feedback directly from students or whoever's viewing the pages?
That's the goal. We've done light student focus groups. Like, you know, we have our student employees. They're probably a little biased. They might be a little more technical than maybe the general mass. We have, you know, some faculty that maybe we'll go out and we'll kind of talk to. A lot of times, though, we make a change, and like, if it's a change someone doesn't like, that is a bad change, like we moved a link or something like that, we'll get feedback right away saying, like, why did you move that terrible link? I need that. Or I think I had one, we had a floating astronaut thing, and a physics professor told me that it didn't float scientifically correctly. Some feedback is more valuable than others. On the bottom is like a feedback link that you can get, you can feedback, but mostly that's like Viagra spam.
You know, Trump is going to come after you.
I didn't say anything terrible about him. He's a great guy.
In what universe? Sorry. That was my inner voice.
Now he's coming after you.
No, that was my inner voice talking too loud. I know. I was going to follow up on his question, I think, about how you're doing this in chunks, like 50 pages at a time. Like, how does that affect your overall site? Because I'm assuming that you're thinking that the site isn't going to go through a major redesign anytime soon. Like, what happens if you guys have a new site, like a new sub-site, whatever, promotional page, that kind of thing? How does that fit into all of this? That's part one of the question. Part two is when you're asking about, or when you're saying that it feeds back into Drupal. How does it feed back into Drupal? What are you using tags? What are you using?
Yeah, okay, so sometimes I'm going to answer part two first. Okay. And then maybe hope you forgot about part one, like a normal politician. The taxonomies are usually like we'll have like kind of private taxonomies that don't actually affect anything on the site, but they're more for ourselves. As far as part one, we're constantly redesigning. We've had 5 or 6 CIOs in the last 6 years, and each one has a different idea of what the web should look like for us. So we've gone through 6 kind of major redesigns. Each of one of those, like we've done content audits, but like we haven't done like a full content audit until the goal was to do it this summer. That obviously is not going to happen. Like we've got through our top pages, but it's going to take a long time.
Yeah, because that's what I was wondering. Like, how do you have a holistic view? How or do you have a holistic view of what your information architecture is like for the entire, you know, universe of Stony Brook content? Because if you don't, then you're going to have these 50 pages over here that may not match meta tags or whatever you want to, like, you know, search terms, blah, 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 with those 50 pages over there. And then you're going to have a new problem where you have content that is mismatched, for instance.
Yeah, so again, like we try to, when we use that tool to kind of evaluate, it takes a date stamp and says, like, we evaluated this page on this date. And then the next time I run the tool, we try not to, you know, we're not going to re-audit the same pages necessarily until we go through the whole list again. But yeah, it's a juggling act, no doubt. We use things like Pattern Lab to kind of help assist with developing the design side of things. The university has kind of branding or writing guidelines that we're also kind of evaluate content against and see if we're good there. Yeah, there's suggestions that change. But yeah, it's a question of change management and getting people to buy in. And I think a lot of times, like just getting in a room and looking at the content, people be like, "Oh my God, that's what it looks like." It's like, you wrote it. Like, what do you mean you don't know? And so I think it's, you know, just making them actually sit down and look at what they're writing and like what they're coming out with. Sometimes like it's our fault. Like a template might break in the way a page, or maybe it used to look really good, but all of a sudden a template change has come in and like affected it, and it's one of those fringe pages, right? But then we'll take ownership and we'll fix it right away, that kind of stuff. We could talk more afterwards. I don't want to use up too much time, too. I'll be at the bar.
Maybe one more? Is there one more? We got one more. Quick one.
In the context of all this content, how does it relate to a mobile site versus something you would use on your computer? In other words, as you're doing all this analyzation and so on and so forth, is any of that work cross over to a mobile site?
We've developed a Pattern Lab based on Bootstrap, and so our templates themselves are highly, like, I don't know if you want to call them mobile first necessarily, or like, if Bootstrap is really true mobile, right? You can have that whole religious debate on that. But like, it does work well on mobile, and it works consistently. I credit that mostly, again, to our pattern lab and the templates that we're building, kind of build that in so our content people don't necessarily have to make those decisions. When they create cards, they can say, I want cards that go, you know, four boxes across. And then the template knows that when you're on a certain size, it's going to go two across or three across. It kind of does that magic for them. We expose some things in paragraphs to allow more flexibility over that. But you know, the more power we're giving out, it's kind of like the more headaches I'm getting in return. So like, it is kind of a balancing act. Our paragraphs used to look a lot like his, with like sections and each had a title. Now we're kind of making more layout-y paragraphs that then put content into them so that you kind of build a frame, like a skeleton, and then you're putting content where you want it. But that's a migration process that's also kind of ties into her question of how do you keep everything kind of on track and that.
All right. All right, thanks a lot, Rich.
Woo!
If you notice, I didn't even attempt to say his last name because, yeah. There's too many consonants. Okay, we're going to get started with our final talk, and I remembered my sheet this time. So Pete and Will are from Blue Cadet, an Emmy Award-winning digital agency. We have also won some Emmy Awards here at NBC. I'm just going to throw that out there. what do we got? Pete specializes at Blue Cadet in Drupal and backend architecture, while Will focuses on content management systems and JavaScript frameworks. And they're going to tell us all about their hybrid decoupled architecture and how they're using paragraphs in said architecture. Take it away, Will and Pete.
Okay. All right, we're just going to go backwards. Okay. All right, cool. All right, so we're just going to go right into introductions. I'm Williamson Vetter. I'm a developer at Blue Cadet. I'm also an adjunct professor at Temple University.
And I'm Pete Inge. I'm a senior developer at Blue Cadet.
And we work for Blue Cadet in Philadelphia. They also just opened up a shop in New York. It's by the High Line, Chelsea. But we're an Emmy award-winning shop. We do websites, touchscreens, apps, pretty much everything digital. We just unveiled a cool 200-square-foot touchscreen in the National Air and Space Museum. That's pretty cool. So our focus is all over the place. But Pete and I, we deal with mostly web. But we're always looking for good Drupal folks, if you guys are interested. We're going to be talking about Brick today. Who here is familiar with Brick? Cool. All right, that's really cool. In Philadelphia, not a lot of people have heard of Brick. But for those who aren't familiar, Brick is a Brooklyn-based organization. They deal with a lot of like public media education. Like if you want to make a TV show or you know want to learn how to use Photoshop, they're a great resource. They also have a lot of quality events. Celebrate Brooklyn is a big thing there. Like Tame Impala played last month. They have a public access television network. And really like a lot of diverse offerings and a lot of audiences and really a wide reach and a really great organization to work with. So Pete?
Yeah, so the Brick, the project that we were doing, it's a fairly large project. We were migrating their old site from a custom CMS to a Drupal 7 site. Just to kind of give you a little overview, we had like 13 content types. We used 17 views throughout the whole thing. And we had a lot of nodes, thousands of nodes. Is that thousands?
Yeah, I think there were like 10,000 plus nodes, but yeah, most of them were events and like past.
A lot of events. So yeah, it was a good size site. It was a good size like migration project. That was a fun part of it.
We had fun with two parts of the site in particular. The hybrid headless components. So like I'll go over it in a little bit. We had a calendars and course listing pages that were really fun to build, and also Pete. Is going to be talking about the modular layout via paragraphs, which was introed quite a bit. So I'm going to go right into the headless, hybrid headless components. And just, this is like a quick hands. Who here has ever implemented a hybrid or a headless setup before? cool. All right, yeah. And who here has been successful at it? And like production? Cool, okay. All right, I just wanna take your temperature on that. But for those who aren't familiar, a headless or a decoupled approach is like a hard separation between the theming layer and the data layer. So Drupal acts as an API to feed into a framework like Angular, React, there are a few others. So that hard separation is what makes it headless. So Drupal just handles the data models, the structure, and then passes it on to the client for consumption and rendering. And for the purposes of this talk, I'm gonna be talking about headless and decoupled synonymously, so just as a heads up. There are a lot of types of headless implementations, so you have fully decoupled, hybrid, CMS to CMS. There are a lot of different ways you can set this up, but I'm just gonna be focusing on the first two, most of the second. Just for the sake of comparison, a non-headless approach is what you see here. There's no separation. Drupal handles the data processing and the theming. So you make the user makes a request to the CMS, Drupal. Drupal interprets it, wraps it all up, and throws the markup back to the user. So the pros, you're already pretty good at it. It's business as usual. Everything is included. But the cons are sometimes there's some slow and expensive asynchronous actions. Like if you've ever done views, exposed filters. Sometimes depending on those, the filtering you're trying to do, that could be pretty slow and expensive. And oftentimes those are also very difficult to extend as well. Again, picking on exposed view or exposed filters on views, it's sometimes difficult to adjust the markup and add classes where you want, get it look like really how you want, per a design or something. On the other side of things, you have the fully decoupled. So that's a full separation. It's what I talked about before. The CMS or Drupal just sends JSON or XML to a JS app like Angular or React, and the JS app interprets that and renders it on the client side. So the pros, you have some really quick interactions because you're not waiting for the server to render that markup. All of it's done on the client side, and it's really, really quick normally. And that also means fully customizable interfaces and markup. The templating languages are very extendable and very friendly to use. And also very easily swappable, front end and back end. So if you have a Drupal back end and an Angular front end, you can easily make that a React front end or a WordPress back end. We've done that on a couple occasions. And because you have that hard separation, it's really hard to swap one of those pieces at the end. The downsides of this approach is you're really missing out on some of the things that Drupal does best. So editing in place, the menu system, routing, built-in login, 404, 403, search. There are just so many components that come for free with Drupal that you just have to rebuild on a fully decoupled site. Also, JS reliance. If you're doing this fully decoupled approach, if the client doesn't have JS or if you're on Amtrak Wi-Fi, it drops a packet, you're gonna have trouble rendering that content. It might not render it at all. So that might be a big deal. Also for proxy browsers, Opera Mini, I know the usage is really small, but it might be a use case. And also SEO and crawler drawbacks, typically because Google has gotten a lot better at interpreting JS frameworks. But a lot of these, a lot of the projects that we've done fully decoupled sites on, we have really poor SEO, and they're not very crawlable. Robots have a hard time interpreting the content on them. But the good news is it doesn't need to be all or nothing. And for Brick, we actually leveraged the strength of both with something I call the hybrid approach. So some sections of the site are headless and some aren't. So think like little applets or calculators, dashboards. So the pros, you have the speedy interfaces when you need it, and you have a robust Drupal framework when you don't. And you can also roll it out in stages, which I'll be covering in a little bit. You still have some of the SEO and crawler downsides for those portions. You're going to have trouble with SEO on those portions that you branch off there. And it's still another framework to learn, develop, and maintain. So depending on your team, that might be a drawback or it could be a plus, depending on if you have a cool React person on your team. But this is a requirement, so I've set it as a con. For the Brick, they have a lot of really cool events. So they wanted a calendar, and you can see this comp that the designer built. And what was envisioned was this calendar where you can toggle months really quickly. There's going to be filtering based on type or whether or not it was a free event, so on. There's also going to be this quick pop-up. Originally, it was going to be on Hover. I think we decided to go with on Click. And it needed to be really, really quick, really snappy interactions. We couldn't wait for the server to interpret our request and then send us back markup. Everything had to be done really quickly. And also, we needed an alternate list view mode, so toggling between these two views. And with Drupal, this is non-trivial, but with this hybrid approach, it was, because the data was already wrapped up for us. It was just a matter of using a different templating, a different template on the client side. And so this was a really trivial thing that we did, and React made it really, really easy for that. So before I get into the technical implementations, I wanted to go over this video. Is it playing? Yeah. Just to show you what it looks like now for some reference. So we have this calendar here toggling through the months. And you can also see we have these filters up here and this alternate view mode. Yeah, Tame and Palette played, which is a really cool show. We can close that if we're not interested, go to another one. But I think what I really want to show you is that these were really quick and instantaneous interactions. And the client was really happy with it. And you can do these filtering. And these aren't, these are custom filters with custom markup. The designer was very adamant about that. And with views, and if you tried to do this with, you know, like a calendar module, a lot of this would be really difficult. And you'd have to tie it with a mess of jQuery. You'd be, you know, just piling together all these modules and scripts and get something really messy. And so finally, we end up on this event page. But this is just a content type. It's business as usual. It's regular Drupal. So that calendar was isolated and its own thing. Some quick implementation details. We created an API using a custom module. I'll go over that in a little bit. We use React on the front end, Redux for state management, Gulp to transform ES6, ES5. We had to implement this robust API caching mechanism because it was really slow had we not. And also we implemented a version of server-side rendering with a view, and I'll be going over this. But just kind of wrap your head around this approach. It says music app, but just imagine it said calendar or something similar. I'm borrowing these slides from a previous talk, but if you can imagine, you know, you have a node template or some other page template or some template you're familiar with, you know, you can render your content in here, and then you can just slap your, you know, app, your calendar, just with the PHP include. It's really, a lot of people have trouble picturing what this looks like, but really it's just a PHP include. And that you can just throw it into a node template. We had a pre-process hook, and we changed the theming suggestion for the calendar page so that it routed to a special node template. But this is just, and then the actual markup. What, you know, I just want to show you that this doesn't work so well. But anyway. Markup that's in there already is kind of like a JS fallback. You can see I'm rendering a view, and then just a no script, you know, just to prevent any flickering that happens. And I'm including some scripts like React, Redux, and Moment. And then my app file structure, it's pretty long, but really the components are about half as many. I had to extend some of these components for the Celebrate Brooklyn calendar, which was quite a bit different. But, you know, the calendar was, you know, a handful of components, but ultimately these are the files that went into the app. And switching into the API, one of the things that we did is we served up all the data at once. We had, I think, like, you know, a couple thousand nodes. You know, during testing, we were serving up a couple thousand nodes. And it seemed like a lot, but we found that when you were serving it all at once, it was a lot less, you know, although it was a huge payload on the initial end, it was a lot better than making a lot of smaller requests. So I'll show you, I have numbers on it later, but what we learned is that just sending a huge ball of data to the client just to keep in memory was a lot more performant than making a lot of smaller incremental requests. Like if we did it by month, that we were thinking about initially. Also, we kind of learned that Drupal's database schema doesn't really lend itself to API creation. So, you know, there's a lot of cruft, a lot of bloat that comes along with Drupal's, you know, the objects that come back with some of these APIs. So we really wanted to strip away all of them and just keep the fields that we wanted, like title, date, time, and other things like that. Which leads me to the next point, is we just preferred using a custom module and a menu hook. Although there are many ways to create APIs, especially with Drupal 8, the RESTful API module, there are a lot of other good ones that come out of the box and just allow you to make APIs right away. But for our purposes, to keep our data light and to just really suit our needs, we rolled out a custom module. And it's really simple. It was just a module that would ping the database. You know, we were querying a simple content type and just bring it back and transform the data. But we had to cache this because, you know, if you were to make a database request every single time, it would be very slow. So the basics of this is that we set a cache after an expensive query and then set the static cache, Drupal page cache, and then we also have Varnish running with Pantheon. Pantheon was really great for this, by the way. And then clear and rebuild the cache on node update or insertion. And I included these hooks. So I made a custom module for busting the cache that we just used a hook node update and hook node insertion. And it would call this cache busting function that I wrote. This was really important because the client a lot of times wanted to see their changes immediately. And when you have, you know, all these layers of caching, it's not really acceptable to say to the client, oh, it could be, you could see it anywhere from, you know, now to like 2 or 3 hours. You know, it's really not acceptable. So we found that, you know, we had to rebuild and flush the cache after every change, no matter how little. So this is what our caching stack looked like. And there were multiple layers of redundancies. And that was really to make sure that the user never rebuilt the database. So if the Varnish cache wasn't set, it would then rely on the Drupal page cache. If that wasn't set, then we would look at the Drupal variable cache, the static cache. But really, the user only ever hit the Drupal page cache or the Drupal Varnish cache, or the Pantheon Varnish cache. So that really allowed for very quick, consistent API fetching results, and just ensured that the user never had to rebuild the data directly from the database. So the results of that were pretty great. If we didn't cache the result, fetching the API alone would, in addition, you know, this is not including bootstrapping the app, loading the DOM, those types of things. It would just be, you know, around three and a half seconds. But as we got to more and more layers of caching, we got that to about 200 milliseconds. And along the way, the results were more consistent every time. So this was a lot of our success. Early on, when there was no caching, you would see the calendar chugging along, that immediate render. So I just wanted to show you that, show you the video again with that knowing, and just, am I playing it? And just notice the little loading that happens. And so that little loading there, that's just the data being fetched. But with so many layers of caching, it was really, really quick, even though we were serving up thousands of events. And so, yeah, we were very pleased with this. And this was isolated in its own little thing. And everything else was Drupal as usual. Then Pete could work on other parts of the site. So I mentioned server-side rendering earlier. And that's just for an initial render. Ideally, you would render a complete content to the client initially. And then subsequent renders would be done on the client side with React or Angular or something. And so what this does is that the SEO, you know, SEO is going to improve. Crawlers can then interpret your content because it's there on initial render, and it doesn't need to bootstrap a JS app and you know, kind of guess what your content is. And it's also a really good JS fallback if you don't have JS on your phone or a packet drops or something like that. And so the way we did that was with a view. And it was really easy. For the purposes of this calendar, we just filtered by, you can see it, just the event content type. And we checked to see if the date was after today. But this was just the view that we use for the backup calendar. And there are some more robust solutions that you can do. We had limited time and hosting resources. You could throw like a Node.js, you know, stack in there. I know Lullabot has done really cool stuff with CouchDB servers, like kind of like in between your client and your server. I don't know a ton about that, so I can just really only talk about the view. But I do know there are a lot of great resources out there for, you know, if you really wanted to engineer this really, 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 really well. And to go back to that include that I showed you earlier, I want to point out that views embed view. And so what that does is it just prints the view right there in that include. So all that content is ready immediately. And so the user might not see it if they have JS installed, which it's hidden. But if there's no scripts or something like that, then this app's hidden content, then it'll show. That's just a little implementation detail. But I really just want to point out that all that content that's in the view is rendered on the server side and sent to the client for that initial fetch. And so I'm going to show you what the site looks like without JS with this fallback. So the fonts aren't loading, but you can see it's not the same. But you know all the content's still there, all the links work, and for SEO that's you know most of the battle. And you know it's not a bad fallback. You know if you have someone wearing like a tinfoil hat and doesn't have you know JS turned on, you know they'll still see the content. They'll still be able to go to these events, and SEOs and you know Facebook whatever can crawl them. So we had a lot of success with this approach for the calendar, and we also had a lot of success with an events listing. So I'll show you what that looks like. They have all these. Courses. They have these really cool courses that they wanted to filter based on different categories, whether if they're free or if they go towards a certification or not. And this was another place where we used this hybrid headless approach just for this isolated piece because it was a finite, limited data set, and also because we wanted to have these quick and snappy interactions. And if we were to do this with a view or something, it would be a lot more arduous and you know difficult, but you know we go into a course and it's just Drupal as usual. So that was a good case where we used this again, but there was another case where we tried to implement the approach, which was the blog, and I don't have a video for it. We decided to end up scrapping it. We took this hybrid approach and you know tried to end up rebuilding the blog and the pagination and the filters and what would be views attachments. And what we found was that we were recreating a lot of functionality. The performance was on par with views. It really wasn't that much better. It made it more difficult to maintain. And the benefits didn't outweigh the drawbacks. So ultimately, we scrapped this and just did it with a view. And so this is actually one of the most important lessons that we learned with this project was because you know, this approach is really great, and you can, you know, use this headless approach anywhere. But really, it's just another tool, and there's a time and a place where you can use it appropriately. And in the case of Brick, there were two places where it was appropriate, and we had great results. But one where we tried it, and we, you know, it was a bit of a failure, or, you know, a little bit of a learning experience, you know, in this case. So that's pretty much the takeaway that I wanted to, you know, convey is that this headless approach is great. It's another tool. You can build really cool isolated applications within your Drupal site. You don't have to go all or nothing. And you can roll it out in stages, like I was talking about. And you can just really end up making a cool product with this technique if it's appropriate. But with that said, the hybrid approach was extremely valuable for Brick, and it yielded a really great result. So that's all I have. I'm going to hand it over to Pete.
Thanks, Will. So yeah, as Will said, we had a lot of fun with the Brick site. And yeah, that calendar, when I looked at the designs at first, I was like petrified of how we were going to do that. Because I've never done a calendar very well in Drupal. So yeah, we're going to move on to paragraphs. So has anybody heard of paragraphs before tonight? or not heard of Paragraphs before tonight. Anybody brand new with Paragraphs? Okay, great, awesome. Well, at least we have somebody. So another thing that we thought was a highlight of the site was the use of Paragraphs. As far as the agency goes, we have been using Paragraphs more and more to help with our modular designs and the designers too, the way our designers work and design, like Paragraphs has been great for us. We really feel like it's enhanced the site, it's enhanced what Brick wanted for the site, for what they loved for the designs. It was really, really a great tool for us to use for this site. And so basically one thing, the way we kind of talk about Paragraphs, if you think about Lego bricks, you can have all different sizes bricks, you can have different color bricks, we can put them all together and it creates one object. So that's kind of like a Paragraphs. There's different little bundles that you can have. And as we saw earlier, we arrange them, we can add whatever we want on a certain page. We don't have to have some of them on a certain page. So Paragraphs is a great tool in that sense, just to bring that modularity around. So today, I just want to walk through kind of our process, my process of why we choose Paragraphs for a site and why we chose it for Brick. Some of the cool stuff that we did outside of, you know, straight up fields and entity references. And then also just kind of go over quickly some of the pros and cons of our the Paragraphs that we saw. So our process, I think two main questions we ask ourselves for using Paragraphs is, and these are kind of obvious in a sense, I think, but also I felt it was good to say. But you know, how do we decide to use Paragraphs, and then how do we use the Paragraph bundles? So the first question, one of the first things that I always think about is what type of site it is. Is it going to be one of these one-off sites where we design it, put it up there, it's going to stay up there, very little editing, they might redesign it and scrap it in a couple years? Or is this a site that's an editor is going to be going in there continually adding content and editing content? For Brick, you know, they're putting up events and exhibitions and blogs and courses all the time. So they have a number of editors going in there to work on the site and to create unique content all the time. You know, they want unique looking content. It's an art house, so like they're into the design and aesthetics. And then the second is looking at the design. Does the content or the body of each design really lend itself for Paragraphs? How would an editor interact with the content? So are they picking content from external sources? Are they picking other nodes? Are they, you know, how are they putting this content on the site? Are they using WYSIWYGs or, you know, creating their own content? And then also, could it be accomplished another way? Paragraphs really is just a tool, like we're talking about with the hybrid approach and everything. It's another tool in the tool belt. It might not be the best option for you, but I think it's a great option in a lot of cases. So, yeah, as a developer, you need to make that call. And I would definitely advise making that call early on. Trying to put Paragraphs in later on hasn't always been as fun to work with then. So these are the designs that we were given. These are just five different page templates that we have. And just, yeah, a quick overview. There's a lot going on here. There's a lot of different designs and things going on. And without Paragraphs or without any type of layout module, I think initially I would have, you know, four or five different ways of approaching this. But really what we did, this is all a landing page content type, and we have all different kind of Paragraph bundles within this. And again, we're using one module, one content type to achieve all these different designs. You can also see, like, again, like I was saying with our designers, they design in this, like, row thing a lot, and that really definitely goes for Paragraphs. It's really easy to design and develop when they design in these rows. And I'll show you a little bit more in detail. So again, once we've decided to use the Paragraph modules, then we kind of re-ask these same questions. How are we going to choose these bundles? How does this content come together? What is the content or the body part of the page? What needs to be flexible? What needs to be rearrangeable? And how, again, is the editor going to interact? How are they going to make changes? What are they going to do with this? Again, we're re-asking the questions, but at this point, we really care about them. So hopefully you can see this. The pink is kind of how we decided to split up everything. So all these different things are different Paragraph bundles. We have a lot of entity references, views references, some custom content. There's a lot going on here. I'll show you another, just kind of the detail page here. Landing page, but the detail of the landing page here. At the top, it's just some text, a WYSIWYG. The second one, we have taxonomy terms. The third one, again, these custom callouts throughout the site. And something to note here, initially, the top to the bottom, lines here, we took as just a one body field, kind of like we saw earlier, and chose a lot of different paragraph bundles for that. But we noticed as we were working through these and trying to develop this, this bottom piece was always very similar throughout the site. And we ended up breaking this up into two different fields. So we had this footer call out, and we had very limited number of bundles that we could put in there, and that kept this footer call out kind of consistent throughout the site. But then the actual content of all the pages, we had, I think, like 12 or 15 different bundles that we could choose from. So the, again, the editor has a lot of freedom to choose what they want throughout the site. Again, as I've said earlier, you give them too much freedom, it could get messy, but that was one thing that they wanted, though. So, and again, so I was showing you landing pages earlier, but this is also a detail page. And I find that this really works well for detail pages because it's cool to have the dynamic dynamic content like this, and I've always had problems with WYSIWYGs and editors and trying, like, oh, I want to rearrange my content, but now all my stuff in the WYSIWYG is messed up. So this really helps with this. So there's a bunch of different paragraph bundles. We have a slideshow at the top. We have a WYSIWYG. We have this custom special button. Again, another WYSIWYG, and then we have a YouTube link. And here's just a video showing a little bit more. So that's just three bundles here. So we have this FAQs kind of bundle, visit brick. I'll explain that a little more in a WYSIWYG. And the editor can go in here, edit the page, rearrange really quickly. So again, you have this detailed page that all of a sudden they decide, oh, well, I have this big picture on the bottom. Now I need it on the top. And if for me, going in a WYSIWYG, I always have to go into the HTML and do everything. But editors who don't know HTML always have a hard time doing that. So again, paragraphs really comes through in that sense for that. And here's just a quick listing of our bundles. We have 25 paragraph bundles for the whole site. Again, they can get long and confusing, and but it really helps out with the editor and giving them a good experience. So this is a quote for just from the paragraphs module page. You can also add custom option fields and do conditional coding in your CSS, JS, and pre-process functions so that end users can have more control over the look and feel of each item. This is way much cleaner and stable than adding inline CSS or classes inside the body field source. Okay, in short, these are entities, and you can do anything you can do with Drupal entities, which provides a whole lot of flexibility as developers for you guys. We have a lot of these bundles that are have kind of global content to them. They're not necessarily custom fields on each one of these. So this is the kind of the fun that we started having with this. So I'll show you a couple of these. I showed these earlier. The top one is taxonomy terms. Again, they're taxonomy terms, so I don't want the editor to go in there every time they're putting this in and typing out the TIDs and all this kind of stuff. The second one is a social media row. So again, social media accounts are global for the whole site. So wherever we have this paragraph bundle, we don't want them to have to type in and mistype it at some point. And this third one is, this is a huge paragraph bundle. This was really complex. At first, we were trying to break it up into a bunch of different bundles. But as we really looked at this, all the content was similar. It was all grouped together. It was for a TV landing page. So it's highlighting different episodes. It's all the different shows on the left and some social media call-outs to the left. So we created one big bundle for this, and it's pulling in some custom entity references. So all these videos, are episodes that are custom references. But then the list on the left, the TV shows on the left, like that's just pulling from a view. Getting a list of all the TV episodes, and we're putting it in there. That's not custom, or the editor is not putting that content in every time that this bundle is being displayed. So I'll show you a little bit how we did this with the Visit Brick bundle. So again, this bundle, it's global content. It's the image of the site. It's the address, the hours. We don't want them to have to redo the hours in 10 different spots where this is showing up. So we have, so let me go to the next slide. So here we can see just in the back end, this is what we see. There's no fields. So this light box right here, if you can see in the middle, there's no fields, there's nothing. It's just a bundle right there. They don't have to do anything. This is a little video. So again, to show you just the editor side again, once we edit that, again, there's not a whole lot to it. We go to edit that bundle. And so the WYSIWYG has a lot of, has the whole WYSIWYG to it. The other one has, what pops, yeah, so that's the like the FAQ call out thing. So we have, you know, an answer and a question. And then the last one is just, there's nothing there. So there's no fields for that VisitBric bundle. But so how do we get the content there? So we created just a settings page just in the back end of Drupal using the normal forms API, nothing special. And this is where all the content goes in, the picture for Brick, the hours, and then the special hours, whatever they have, like so holidays they can put up there. And again, using Drupal hooks, I use the hook preprocess entity. And you can see here we are targeting the paragraphs item as the entity type, and then we're checking for the paragraph item, the visit brick paragraph item. We're grabbing this settings from the variable get, the settings from that form, and then we're just populating it into the variables array. And then when we have a template, so this is the paragraphs item dash dash visit brick template, we're just printing out these variables. And again, this is very straightforward, you know, typical Drupal stuff. It's nothing too crazy and all that. But again, just a good way to take these paragraphs and be able to do some custom content with them, or global content with them. There is some stuff, I mean, you could, I've always been asked, you know, well, why not just use blocks or something like that? And there's different pros and cons for using each one of these. Obviously, you're in content, so it's nice to have that field and the different options for that field and stuff like that. So just to go over some pros and cons. Flexibility. So first of all, it's really flexible. Editors, experience that I've seen have always enjoyed this. They can rearrange their content. They can have fun with their content. Again, the 1 through 4 here is all kind of somewhat similar, but I think it's definitely different. Modular and the reorder content and reusability. Just overall, the content editor experience is less frustrating as number 5. And then scales easily for future development. Clients always come back and say, well, can we do this now? And all we need to do is add another bundle instead of, you know, having to redo some code or redo some templates or anything like that. Cons, flexibility. Again, I put this one up here on the cons as well. Again, with more flexibility, editors really can screw things up. So we have to be careful about some of that kind of stuff. Templates can get complicated quickly. So a paragraph field can be inside a paragraph field, which can be inside a paragraph field. And we've had some crazy ones at some point. I don't think we had any of them with Brick. But you can go like, I think we had an easy one of 8 levels deep with templates, and it was ridiculous to try to like figure it out. It was insane. But because of, like, again, you have a lot of different options and stuff like that, so you just have to be careful. And also, it's another entity, paragraphs, items, or entities. So when you're loading a node, each item in your paragraph field is another entity, so Drupal's going through that whole process. Depending on the size of your site, this could be a performance issue. If you're trying to load these nodes into an API or something like that, you're going through that whole process with nodes each and every time. So again, just something to think about. It's not necessarily a terrible con, but it is that. So that's about the quick overview with paragraphs and why we did it with Brick. Thank you very much for having us here. It's great. Did you get the repo?
Yeah, and I think I just posted this. Hopefully it finished uploading. So that was a lot thrown at you. Do you have any questions?
Hey, so going back to your calendar module, you said that you pushed out all the data like all at once, right?
Yeah.
But then you're just pushing out your, for all your images, though, you're just pushing out your the URLs of those images.
Correct.
And then your React applicate like thing just fetches those as necessary.
Correct.
As they're requested.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Hello. I don't know as much about paragraphs. We used to, or I'm more used to blocks. So can I, as a content editor, build my own page using the paragraphs?
Yes. Short answer, yes.
Okay. And so then how does SEO work with the paragraphs?
It's all HTML. I mean, it's nothing crazy or special with it. It's all same stuff.
Okay.
Yeah, using templates, normal templates in Drupal and all that.
Oh, I wasn't cutting in line. I was handed the microphone next. You had shown a caching slide earlier,
yeah.
And the varnish and the Drupal variable and all that. And you mentioned like the user never hits a non-cached issue. Do you regenerate that content like as soon as it expires then basically?
It never expires. I mean, because all it is just it's calendar content. So if they don't add anything, if they don't update anything, it really never goes stale in that sense. It's only ever rebuilt, if the content admin adds a new event, for instance. And so then that data set is no longer true. You know, it's not a complete data set without that event. So once you add a new event, then it blows away everything, reconstructs it, and then pushes it to the cache. Same thing if you update.
So that part right there, it automatically pushes it into the event?
Yeah, so that was the hook. I have to go back several slides, but we use a hook node update, hook node insert, and yeah, here. And so what this calls is a helper function that just rebuilds it, pushes it into the static cache, and then so then the page cache loads it, and then Varnish caches it. So when you rebuild this, at the very least, it's in static cache. So even if the user, even if there's a miss on Varnish and it's not cached with Drupal page cache, at the very least, it's going to be in this lower level. And we tested this very thoroughly. And it's actually not perfect. If they delete a node or if they add a taxonomy term, for instance, they have to manually do that, which is something we've encountered a couple times with the client. Sometimes they'd say, oh, we added a taxonomy term, but the caching busting module wasn't, we just didn't put in the work to, encompass like all these different cases. But node insertion and node update were enough of the normal cases to need to rebuild that cache so that the content is accurate on the production server. Does that make sense?
Sort of.
Okay, yeah, you can.
Thank you.
I can try to explain it a little bit more later.
So the content, I'm just wondering about future upgrade and future update. Once you're using paragraphs, if you are then in 3 years from now going to want to migrate this content someplace else, is there a lot of the information that paragraphs is inserting then stored in the actual node data?
Yeah, so the paragraph item itself is an entity. So we can load those individually. And they're all fieldable. You can do all that kind of stuff to them. So some of these global ones, you might not be like migrating. And honestly, I don't know. You might not necessarily need to migrate those. But anything that's fieldable or content like that, it can easily be migrated. It is connected to the node. It's attached to the node. So you can easily, you have all your IDs. You can reference everything. Going through migration, I've done a couple two paragraphs. I don't think I've done anything out of paragraphs. But it's a couple step process. It adds a couple more steps, but it still works pretty well, pretty easily.
Are you saying that once you put it into this different schema, then like having nodes and content types that are nicely separated and organized, that it kind of like shuffles up your content a little bit?
No, what I'm thinking is more that actually if you were going to export a table that is just the nodes, the content that is in there is going to include a lot of information about the paragraphs that are in that node. So it won't actually, if you're not going to be using paragraphs, it won't then render in another Drupal installation without that installed correctly. So you would have to either do something to sort of break it out.
Yeah. So just like you have all your content types for the nodes, you have the bundles, which is the content type for the paragraph item. So you definitely need that. If you're going to do it, one-to-one, you're definitely going to need that. Or you could migrate it, I guess, into, like, one big text field or something like that. Does that answer?
Yeah.
So you either need the paragraphs, same bundles in the paragraphs, or another plan for migrating all that data. Yeah.
So I had a quick question. Revisions and workflow stuff, how does that work with this? Because I know, like, Panelizer, it took a long time to get Panelizer to the point where it'd see revisions and you'd have workflow and things like that. Is that here with that?
It works. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head now. It definitely works with revisions. I believe each of those entities have revisions as well. So when you save a node revision, it does save a paragraph item revision. Don't quote me on that.
Yeah,
but I do know we have revisions on another site. I don't think we have revisions on Brick.
Or we're not.
Oh, is that okay?
Sorry, not the module depends on a set, not entity reference, but entity revision reference module. So I think every paragraph is a multi-value field with a reference to the revision of the paragraph entity.
Yes. Yeah. There we go.
Okay. Thanks.
Thanks. I know we have it working on a site. I just couldn't remember.
Any more questions?
Any more?
So I just want to say thank you. Like, kind of hit a lot of the things that we're trying to solve too, and like it's nice to see similar approaches right to the same problems. So your question, we've had issues in the past where like subparagraphs, if you put something from like if you have a published version and you're creating a draft version, it would sometimes just delete your paragraphs on you. But there's a patch in the issue queue now that kind of fixes that behavior. Same thing with field collections. And to your point, we've migrated from like one paragraph bundle to another. Like we've been able to write some custom code to do that. So like I was able to like migrate 800 kind of like pages that had paragraphs on them from one kind of paragraph type to another. We cleaned up some fields. So we, you know, early on we kind of made some mistakes with our architecture, I would say, that we tried to standardize against. So it's very like you're getting more and more structured data, and that's what Drupal's really good at.
Yeah.
So you get out of that kind of body field situation that like you find yourself in where you maybe you want to change a template and you can't. And this gives you that ability to kind of like grow and flex. So I think it's really good, but it is gets messy. You get those 8 layers of paragraphs deep, and there's some headaches there. But
that was one of the issues in reverse with Brick, their old site. There was a lot in that body field and a lot of HTML in that body field. And when we migrated, I mean, there's a lot of cleanup with it. But again, in that reverse, that you can't pull anything out without doing some crazy string finding and replacing and all that fun stuff. So it definitely chunks everything out into to smaller bits of data, which is great, I think.
Anything else? I mean, we love talking about this stuff, so if you guys have any more questions, just feel free to ask us later. We'll be at the after party thing.
Yay, thanks.
Thank you.
All right, everybody, thank you very much. Thank you, guys. Alex had to go home, so I'm the fill-in MC for right now. We have some more pizza left. Stick around, socialize a little bit. We'll be opening up the tab for the party maybe around 8:45. So if you head to Bill's Bar and Burger, that sounds about right. But otherwise, stick around, socialize a little bit. What time is it now? 8:23, so maybe about 20 minutes, and then we'll party, and do some more socializing. We usually keep the tab open until 10 o'clock or so, and hope to see most of you there. All right. Next meetup. Sorry. I did the slide. Yeah, well, go back one slide. Whoever. That's fine. Well, next meetup is next Wednesday of the month. It's the first Wednesday of every month, September 7th. All right, we'll see you guys there, and see you at the party. Thanks.